lecture by Professor Daniel Harlow. It's possible to ask questions when you want during the lecture using the chat. As usual, you can write Q for questions and for follow-up questions. It's possible to find the recording on summer school website. Well, I give the floor to Professor Harlow.
Hi, thank you. So last time we talked about black holes in semi-classical gravity, just basically quantum field theory and curved space-time, maybe a little bit of back reaction to allow the black hole to evaporate. And we got fairly far using those techniques, together with some general intuition. But at some point we need an actual theory of quantum gravity. Until we have an actual theory, it's just kind of too speculative. We never really know whether what we're saying is making sense or is consistent or not. Now, so far, unfortunately, as we've been discussing, it's hard to find theories of quantum gravity. And as we said in the first lecture, so far there is no one has found a realistic theory of quantum gravity. Every theory of quantum gravity that we have either has inconsistencies or is consistent with itself, but not with the observational data. And so the philosophy that I and many others have taken is that at least for now, it's more important to try to find a theory that's consistent with itself than it is to find one that's consistent with the data. Of course, in the end, that's important too, right? I mean, we're trying to do science. In physics, there's a long history of studying toy models. I mean, cows are also not spherical, right? But some things about cows we can understand by pretending that they are. And so in that spirit, we're going to spend this lecture and also most of the next lecture thinking about the unrealistic case of quantum gravity with negative cosmological constant. And the reason for doing that is because in that setting, we're able to formulate theories of quantum gravity with a relatively high level of rigor and calculability. And so then we can really use that to test ideas about black hole physics. Okay. Now, it could always be the case that somehow the black holes in AdS work differently than the black holes in the real world. We don't really know. That's ultimately an experimental question. But since currently we don't have any way of understanding the puzzles of black hole physics, if there's one way that seems consistent, then it's at least plausible that that might be how it actually works. And maybe we can, in the future, think of more ways to test it directly. So we're going to talk about AdS CFT. Okay, so what is AdS CFT? Well, very roughly, it says that quantum gravity in asymptotically anti-de Sitter space, which is kind of a mouthful, so we'll just call it AdS from now on, is equivalent to conformal field theory living at its boundary. There's a question from Eric. Okay, did I already say something offensive? Okay, please.
No, not at all. Well, maybe a little bit. I don't want to get you off track, but I actually really am interested in this question about what you mentioned, the possibility that black holes in AdS may not work the same as in something like the real world. I'm wondering, one of the things I've thought about this, and I've had long arguments with Aaron Wall about, is that, one of the reasons why AdS is so nice for doing all this stuff is that it's basically a big box, and doing thermodynamics in a box, we always do thermodynamics in boxes, a gas in a box. A gas in a box has well-defined thermodynamic properties. Yeah. But an unconfined gas, it's really hard to give that a good thermodynamics, which is, what we think that like DS is not a box. So do you have any thoughts about that, about whether that might be relevant?
Well, I mean, so that is relevant, but what if the box is really big and the black hole is really small, right? So, my intuition would suggest that if the box is a billion light years across and the black hole has the size of a centimeter, then the physics of the black hole shouldn't depend too much on the details of the box. And so if you're willing to accept that argument, then you should accept that at least small black holes in AdS should work in the same way as black holes in flat space or maybe even De Sitter space. Now, of course, I can't prove that, but I don't think it's a crazy thing to consider.
No, it's not at all. Thank you. That's really helpful.
Yeah. Maybe the key thing to emphasize, right, is that this conformal field theory, so I'll say more about what conformal field theory is later, but I want to emphasize that this is non-gravitational, right? This is just some quantum field theory. So this is saying something that sounds mysterious and deep or confusing, quantum gravity, full non-perturbative quantum gravity, is equivalent to something that sounds simpler, which is just quantum field theory without gravity. And okay, so I mean, at the level of rigorous mathematics, we don't understand quantum field theory very well, but we certainly understand it a lot better than we understand quantum gravity. And so this is saying that something we really don't understand very well at all is related to something that we understand pretty well, although not to our complete satisfaction. And so that's good. That means that we can try to learn about quantum gravity by using this. Now, if you really want to be a stickler for logical precision, which I guess you're philosophers, so you like to be when you can, then perhaps the most conservative interpretation of this is that we say that this should really be viewed as a definition. So this side we understand, this side we don't. And so we just define this thing that we don't understand as the thing that we do understand. And then we ask whether it has the properties that we would expect from a theory of quantum gravity if we define it that way. And so it's fine to think about this like that. You know, there's a hope, which so far has not been realized in detail, that there should be some independent definition of the left-hand side, something like type 2B string theory propagating in the space-time or something. But so far, that version of the definition is only makes sense in perturbation theory. So if you want to be safe, it's fine to think about this as a definition. But then there's still a non-trivial question, which is it a good definition? Now, this correspondence was discovered by studying the physics of D-brains in string theory. These days, it's usually considered as a self-contained logical framework, which is mostly...
Yeah. There is a...
Oh, yeah, Eric, okay.
A question?
Yeah.
I promise I won't interrupt you every 5 minutes. This is the last one for a while. Yeah. But I do have a question, just a very general question about how to think about AdS, about quantum gravity and asymptotically AdS.
Yeah.
So I always hear the claim, which you just made, that it's like fully non-perturbative quantum gravity. But if it's an asymptotically AdS, then at least asymptotically, there has to be enough classical space-time geometry to make sense of that asymptotic condition. So it always seemed to me like it's a theory of quantum, you're not considering like all possible states of a theory of quantum gravity, you're considering like a subset of quantum gravity states that are such that they have they asymptotically look classical.
Well, so when you-
Is, that,
when you,
is that right?
Well, I wouldn't quite say it that way. So it's okay. I would just say when you have physics in a box, you need to have boundary conditions at the edge of your box. If you don't, the dynamics is not well defined. So to define this idea of quantum gravity in asymptotically anti-De Sitter space, you need to put boundary conditions in the box. And there's kind of an order of limits kind of issue. So if you think about, for example, black holes of larger and larger mass sitting in AdS, then those will disrupt the space-time further and further out. And we allow this theory to have black holes of arbitrarily large mass. Okay. But nonetheless, for any particular black hole, eventually the mass will, you know, you'll get out far past the Schwarzschild radius and the geometry will start looking like AdS again. So the way you can think about it is that any state which has finite energy is going to eventually obey these boundary conditions. If you try to put structure kind of all the way out to infinity, you're going to get a state that has infinite energy. And we usually view those as not being part of the Hilbert space. I mean, in fact, in the boundary quantum field theory, you know, if we try to get it from a lattice theory, there are also states of infinite energy, you know, product states and so on, which we view as not being part of the continuum theory. So you know, it's just like in flat space, right? When you talk about gravity in flat space and you try to phrase it as a dynamical system, you usually impose fall-off conditions on the fields, that they fall off with some power. And of course, the coefficient of the power can be as large as you want. And so that can make the radius before it gets small to be as large as you want. But for any allowed state, it's eventually going to be small.
Thank you. That's really helpful.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I was talking about how this correspondence, it was discovered in string theory. These days, we usually consider it as a self-contained logical framework. And so the connection to string theory is less apparent than it was originally. But I want to emphasize that it remains the case that all of the actual examples that we have of this correspondence, which have the property that on the gravity side of the correspondence, we have Einstein gravity to a good approximation, all of the examples still come from string theory. So, you know, you can talk about the rules and the framework in general without talking about string theory, but whenever you want to have an actual example, then you have to learn about string theory. In particular, like the most famous example is this 2B string theory in ADS5 times S5, which is dual to N equals 4 super Yang mills, right? So the sort of canonical example. Is the one where you have 2B strings in ADS5 times S5, which is equivalent to this SUN Yang Mills theory in 3 plus 1 dimensions with N equals 4 supersymmetry. Okay. So this is like this was the first example that was discovered by Maldacena by studying deep brain physics. It's kind of the workhorse. Whenever we're confused, we're hung up on some general point, we first go and think about what happens in this example. And then sometimes if we want to be in some dimension other than 3 plus 1 on the boundary, then there are other examples that we can also think about. In the long run, it's unclear whether this correspondence can really be thought of independent from string theory. You know, if all the examples come from string theory, then probably not. But nonetheless, I'm not going to talk about string theory anymore in these lectures. We'll just see how far we can get without having to worry about the details of any particular example. Now, to proceed further, I have to tell you something about AdS, and I have to tell you something about CFT, and then once we're happy with both of those, then we can try to understand what they have to do with each other. So let's start with AdS. So by convention in this subject, we always have the AdS living in D plus one dimensions, so that the boundary theory is living in D dimensions. So I'll abide by that convention just because I'll confuse myself if I don't. Oh, there's a question from Manus Visser.
Yes, hi. So I read your essay, What Black Holes Can Teach Us About Quantum Gravity. And there so I have a question about emergence and.
Well, let's hold off on that for a minute because I'm going to talk about that later in the lecture, okay?
Okay, sure.
Yeah, I promise we're going to come back to that, but we're going to first try to state the correspondence more precisely before we try to think about what it means.
Okay. Yeah, I think it's a really interesting question, but we can come back to it.
Yeah, let's definitely come back to it. So what is AdS D plus one? Okay, it's the this is the definition of this is that it's the maximally symmetric solution of Einstein equation with a cosmological constant that's less than zero. Okay, so in terms of coordinates, we can write the metric like this. This quantity L is called the AdS radius. It's just some length, or sorry, okay. So you can see that if I take this parameter L to infinity, then this R squared over L squared and this R squared over L squared here go away. And this just again becomes the flat space metric in polar coordinates. Okay. So this L kind of sets the scale at which the geometry starts looking different from flat space. And at distances which are large compared to this L, then you can detect the negative curvature. You can sort of start telling that you're living in a world with negative curvature. So what does it mean to live in a world with negative curvature? Well, let me try to draw a picture here. I'm going to try to draw ADS 3, since drawing ADS 4 is again beyond my limited abilities. This radial coordinate, we can think of it going out like this. So it's most natural to think about this as the interior of this cylinder. And then there's some angular coordinates that go around here. So in ADS 3, there's only one angular coordinate. This sphere here just becomes a circle. That's why it's easy to draw. In four dimensions, the circles here would become two spheres. And then I'll leave it to your imagination what the picture should look like. So the key thing is that if I'm sitting here in the center of the space at r equals zero, let's put me down here. And then I shine like a laser pointer away from me. The key thing is that it reaches the boundary at finite time and then comes back to me. Over some proper time, proper time, which is of order this radius of curvature. Okay, so if I take the radius of curvature to infinity, then if I shine the laser pointer, it never comes back to me, which is what you expect in flat space, right? But in a space with negative cosmological constant, somehow, well, you may know, like with positive cosmological constant, right, the expansion of the universe accelerates away from you, right? So somehow with negative cosmological constant, everything is kind of rushing in towards you. And in particular, if you throw, I guess this is Italy. So if you throw a football away from you, if you kick a football away from you, in ADS, it will turn around and come back to you in a finite time. And it's true even if you, instead of kicking a football, you shine a laser pointer because the space time is just how all coming in at you. So everything kind of gets pulled back with some time, which is of order this ADS radius. So like Eric was saying, we can think about this as living in some kind of box, right? Because that's also true, of course, if you live in a box with reflecting walls, that if you shine a laser at the wall, then it bounces off the wall and comes back to you in some finite time. Any questions about the ADS geometry?
Yes, maybe coming back to the thing you've drawn, can you explain the Penrose diagram?
Oh, yeah, sure. So the Penrose diagram for this, it just looks like an infinite vertical strip where this side is r equals zero and this side is r equals infinity. So here it's basically like I suppress the angular direction here, okay? So in this cylinder picture, light moves on 45 degrees, and of course that's true in the Penrose diagram as well. So then this thing that I drew there is just something like that. Does that make sense?
That's what you mentioned before with the reflection at the boundary of the box.
That's right, yeah. So in the Penrose diagram, this side is the origin of polar coordinates at r equals zero. So in the cylinder picture, that's the center of the cylinder. And then this side is the AdS boundary that you can bounce off of.
Mm-hmm. The asymptotic to the antithesis theta. Okay.
Yeah, that's right.
Thanks.
Just to clarify, in your first diagram, you had L, and I mean, in the picture, it looks like a time scale, but here you're working in sequel to one, so that then scale and time scale are.
Oh, yes, of course. Same. I'm sorry. I reflexively set C and H bar to one. I have to try really hard not to do it. So.
No, that's okay. I just want to confirm that, you know, because you said it's the length scale at which it becomes clear that you're living in a negatively curved space. So I'm just sort of thinking experimentally, can you also see it really as an experiment that involves going out?
So you can ask, like, what does the spatial geometry look like at a fixed time, right? So then it's kind of like the spatial geometry is like this disk, okay? And the geometry of this disk is like, if you've ever seen this sort of Escher kind of pictures, right? It's kind of this negatively curved kind of, you know, so these circles that I'm drawing here are all geodesics. Okay, I don't know if I'm making this picture better or worse, but anyway, it's some negatively curved thing. So yeah, the funny thing about it is that the proper distance from here to the boundary is infinity. You know, if you think about, like, you've probably seen the Escher picture with the angels and demons. So there are infinitely many angels and demons to get from the center to get from to the edge. But nonetheless, if you shine a laser pointer out to the edge, it reaches it and comes back in finite time. So that's the kind of funny feature of ADS. So it's actually, both things are important, right? Because usually it's hard to put gravity in a box because, you know, what if you make a black hole and it bangs into the side of the box? That's kind of hard to think about. But somehow in ADS, you can make it work by sort of secretly having the edge be infinitely far away, but nonetheless being able to signal to it and have it come back.
Right. Okay. And in terms of the spatial geometry, if you, like, L is still the distance scale at which, let's say, if you draw a triangle, its interior angles will start adding up clearly.
That's right. So, like, if you, if you start with parallel lines in the Escher picture, it's like the distance you have to go before you see that they're deviating.
Yeah. Thanks.
Okay, so this is ADS. Of course, this asymptotically ADS that I put here is important because we're trying to do quantum gravity, and it would be pretty boring quantum gravity if the geometry was always just this ADS geometry. Okay, so we should allow for matter to be present, which disrupts the geometry locally in the center of the cylinder. So this idea of asymptotically ADS space is that, okay, if I'm sitting here, then, you know, I source some gravitational field and that changes the metric a little bit near me, but then far away, it goes back to this metric. Okay, that's this idea of asymptotically ADS. And in particular, there's an ADS version of the Schwarzschild geometry. So let me write that. So I'll write it in two steps to make the equation a little simpler. Dr squared over f of r plus r squared d omega d minus 1 squared. And then this f of r is 1 plus r squared over l squared minus 16 pi g m over d minus 1 omega d minus 1 r to the d minus 2. Okay. So if you ignore this term, this is, and you set d equals to 3, which makes the bulk four-dimensional, then this just becomes the Schwarzschild metric that we had before. But now there's also this AdS, right? If we set M to zero, then it just becomes AdS. But if we have both terms, then this is kind of describing the back reaction on the AdS geometry due to having some object of mass M sitting in the center of the space. And S we discussed in the flat case, if you just take this geometry by itself, then it actually does not describe an object sitting in AdS. It describes a wormhole connecting two AdS universes. But then if you include some matter and you collapse it in AdS, then you'll have some black hole where to the outside of the matter, you collapse the geometry, it'll look like this. And that'll be an AdS black hole. Okay, so that was all I was going to say about AdS for now. I'm going to go on to CFT. So any more questions about AdS? Okay. So on to CFT. Okay, so we already talked about quantum field theory in the last lecture. So I don't have to introduce quantum field theory again. And in particular, we talked about relativistic quantum field theory, which had Poincaré symmetry. Okay, which was some symmetry where we do a coordinate transformation of space like this, where this lambda mu nu is required to preserve the Minkowski metric. Okay, and so this is these are Lorentz transformations, boosts and rotations. This A mu are spatial and temporal translations. So that's what we mean by relativistic quantum field theory, is that it's symmetric under these transformations. So a conformal field theory, in addition to this Poincaré symmetry, has two further spacetime symmetries. So it has dilation symmetry, which is a symmetry where you just rescale all the coordinates of space uniformly. So, you know, everything that you used to call a meter, you now say is 2 meters, something like that. And then there's something called special conformal transformations, special conformal symmetry, which is a little bit more complicated, but I'll write it just so that you've seen it once in your life, hopefully not for the first time, but maybe for the first time. So it looks like this. So then there's some, we have some arbitrary vector. Actually, let me not call it A mu because I used A mu for translation. So let me call it B mu. X squared over 1 plus 2 B alpha X alpha plus B squared X squared. Okay. So this is some further set of coordinate transformations under which the theory is supposed to be invariant. So it may seem a bit weird. I mean, why, you know, where on earth did this crazy formula come from for special conformal transformations, right? So where this comes from, so Poincaré transformations are the most general transformations that preserve the lengths and angles and relative angles of vectors in Minkowski space. Okay, that's how the Poincaré group is defined. It has to preserve the metric, which means it has to preserve the lengths of vectors and the angles between them. Okay. So the conformal group is defined as the set of transformations which preserve only the angles, but not necessarily the lengths. So that's a weaker requirement, so more transformations are allowed. And in fact, the ones that are allowed are the Poincaré ones together with these ones, you know, combined with everything you get, you know, plus everything you get by combining them, right? So this whole thing together is called the conformal group. So in any conformal field theory, there can't be any dimensionful parameters, you know, parameters with units like mass or length. Because if there were, then you could never have this dilation symmetry, right? Because, you know, like if you rescale all the masses in the world by two, then that's not a symmetry because the electron has some mass, for example. Okay, so you can't just, you know, take the Earth and make everything twice as heavy and have it work in the same way, right? It's not going to work. So in order to have conformal symmetry, in particular, like if you have particles, then all the particles have to be massless. That's the only way to have conformal symmetry. So conformal symmetry is not a symmetry of the standard model, for example, because it has all these masses. But there are other physical systems that do have conformal symmetry, you know, with maybe the most famous example being the water at right at the liquid gas phase transition. Another famous example is the Ising model right at the transition from magnetization to not being magnetized. So in conformal field theory, operators are, you know, local operators are classified by how they transform under these conformal symmetries. And so in particular, there is something called primary operators. So I'll write the definition and then explain it. So an operator O is primary if it has the following two transformation laws, O of X, e to the minus I d alpha equals e to the alpha delta O of O of e to the alpha x and e to the I b mu k mu O of zero e to the minus I b mu k mu is O of zero, where d is the generator of dilations. Okay, so this first equation says that under this rescaling of the space-time, the operator itself just rescales in some simple way, where this factor delta here is called the conformal dimension of the operator. And then this K is the generator of these special conformal transformations. So the details of this don't matter too much. It's just that these are operators that transform particularly simply under conformal symmetry. You can show that all the other operators can be generated from these ones by taking derivatives. So these are kind of the fundamental operators in a conformal field theory. And we're just going to have to know that they exist and that each of them comes with this number delta, which is called its conformal dimension. Okay, and this delta is always positive. Okay, so that's all I was going to say about conformal field theory. Any questions about conformal field theory?
Maybe you will pick up on this later, but how do you define the boundary on which conformal fields are evolved?
The boundary? You mean in the AdS CFT correspondence or?
Well, if going back to the sketch you've shown in the very beginning, we have AdS in the bulk, and then on the right we have a conformal field theory defined on the boundary. Right. So how does the boundary get?
Yeah. So in this cylinder picture, right, it's the boundary of the cylinder. So the in this AdS 3, right, it would be dual to CFT 2, which would live on, you know, where it would be labeled by this theta and t, and it would kind of be living at r equals infinity.
I see. So it is on the boundaries of the cylinder, essentially.
Yeah, it's on the boundary of the cylinder.
Yeah.
And the argument you gave yesterday about the entanglement in the ground state works here too, right? Because nothing has really changed about...
For conformal field theory, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, conformal field theory is just a special case of relativistic field theory. So everything I said about relativistic field theory is true here. Okay, so that's AdS and CFT separately. Now let's do AdS-CFT. So here's the claim. Any CFTD, meaning a CFT living in D space-time dimensions, which is quantized on a spatial sphere, SD minus one. So the space-time that I'll study the conformal field theory on is a spatial sphere times time. It's sometimes called the Einstein static universe, although that's a pretty pretentious name for a situation where we're not even including gravity. So then we say is equivalent to a theory of quantum gravity in asymptotically ADS D plus one times M space where M is some compact manifold. We'll give it an exclamation mark. Or maybe we should use chess notation. We'll call it like triple exclamation mark. Okay. So we're mostly going to ignore M in these lectures, but I have to say it because in the examples that we know, it's always there. So for example, like in this canonical example that I mentioned in the beginning, right? We really had ADS5 times S5. We have some other manifold lying around. That somehow, you know, because the examples come from string theory and string theory likes to have a higher number of dimensions, we often have this M lying around. We think that in general, we can make the M very small, in which case we can ignore it. But explicit examples of that have not been constructed so far. So I have to mention it in the definition, but I'm probably not going to mention it again unless you bother me about it. So I'll mostly assume that M is trivial so that we're in one of the hypothetical examples where it's small. Okay, so that's the claim. This leads, however, to some immediate questions, okay, which are probably bothering some of you already. So obvious questions. So the first obvious question is, what does equivalent even mean, right? So, or more precisely, what is the map, sometimes called the dictionary, between ADS observables and CFT observables. Right, clearly, if we can't answer that question, then this is like a totally useless claim, right? So we have to be able to say if there's some physics question you're interested in ADS, what's the CFT calculation you should do to learn about it, right? Question number two is which CFTs are equivalent to what I'll call semi-classical gravity theories which approximate Einstein gravity when this anti-de-Sitter radius L is much bigger than the Planck length. Okay. And this is an important question too, because since we define the correspondence to hold for any conformal field theory whatsoever, right? In particular, this claim says that the Ising CFT that describes the ferromagnetic phase transition is equivalent to a theory of quantum gravity. But it's a theory of quantum gravity that's not very much like the gravity that we know about. You know, it's not described by Einstein gravity in any good approximation. And so if we want to think about quantum gravity that looks anything like our quantum gravity, and in particular where we can do the thing I said to Eric about studying black holes that are small compared to the AdS radius and still hoping that they're described by Einstein gravity, then that's going to be some subset of the CFTs at best that has that property. Okay, and so we should try to think about what's the subset that does that. Okay, before trying to answer the questions, let's me pause and ask if you have other questions.
Maybe just a small clarification point. So when you say semi-classical gravity theory, So just now you're saying that if we take, for example, as a CFT, the one describing the ferromagnetic phase transition, then the gravity theory is going to be quite different from Einstein gravity. So when we say semi-classical gravity theory, what do we mean actually by gravity theory in this situation? What is the operative definition? It's something with a matrix, something with a, could we have, for example, a topological theory in the bulk?
Yeah, so I'm going to give you a definition in a few minutes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Other questions?
Yeah, just a quick clarification. So when you wrote down AdS, you just wrote down its metric, but you haven't defined a quantum theory on it yet, right? So.
Yeah, but we could certainly, so we have an action, right? Of Einstein gravity with negative cosmological constant and with some matter fields. And in perturbation theory, we can try to quantize that using the path integral. But that's not, how should I say that? I mean, as we discussed before, that doesn't really make sense non-perturbatively. So what we're hoping for is something which approximates that in the regime where that should be a good approximation, but then, is different in general in such a way that it gives a well-defined theory.
Yeah, I guess my question was, since you, in your first obvious question, you said, what is the map between AdS observables and CFT observables? I'm just trying to get a sense of what AdS observables.
Yeah, well, I think this will be more clear in a minute. We're going to talk about some of, these two questions I'm going to try to answer in a minute. So yeah. But other questions other than what are the answer to these questions?
In question one, you mentioned you talk about the map only between observables. Is it always the case, or is it sometimes the case that doing that also gives you a map between the dynamics, or is that a totally separate issue?
Yeah, I would say that's part of the story because the Hamiltonian is an observable as far as I'm concerned. So.
Okay, so the Hamiltonian and CFT gives you the AdS dynamics.
Yeah, that's right. I'm about to discuss that.
Okay, thank you.
If I prescribe a classical geometry in the bulk by giving you the initial data, it's asymptotic AdS. Is there a CFT state due to it?
Well, that question could be answered at various levels. In general, I think the answer is probably no, because there's some pretty crazy things you can write down, like you can write down an AdS black hole with the inflating multiverse behind the horizon. And that probably doesn't correspond to something in AdS CFT. But at least if you consider states, say, without black holes, you know, planets and so on, then yes, I think the answer is yes.
Okay.
Once there are black holes, then it's a little bit more puzzling about, you know, because there's a lot of initial data you can put behind a black hole horizon. And in fact, you can put a lot more than A over 4G's worth of initial data behind a black hole horizon. And that shouldn't all really correspond to independent states in the dual CFT. But this is something that we're still kind of puzzled about, you know, which of the initial data actually correspond to valid states of quantum gravity.
Is there already a recipe to do that? Like translate the say without black hole, but translating the initial data to the
boundary. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I may mention it a little bit next time, but it probably, you know, I'm trying to avoid too many equations here, so probably I won't give the details next time.
Okay.
Okay. So maybe I should continue. So the basic idea for answering question one. So for question one. Is that we think there exists a vector space isomorphism from HCFT to HADS. So somewhat like something like what you were just asking. So every state of the CFT is mapped to some state in the quantum gravity theory. That makes sense. Now this is the non-perturbative quantum gravity theory, not the perturbative one, which is related to the question that was just asked. And then some of these states will correspond to states that are sort of simple in the bulk, but every state will correspond to something in the bulk, okay, and vice versa. So it's an isomorphism. And moreover, we expect that this isomorphism preserves the symmetries. So if UCFT is a global symmetry of the CFT, so this could be like a time translation, rotations, etc. Okay. How should I say this? Then there exists an asymptotic symmetry UADS of the ADS theory such that these things obey the obvious thing. So let me see if I can try to write it in the right order. So if we act with UCFT, and then we act with phi, then that's the same as if we had acted second with UADS and first with phi. Okay. So I think mathematicians call this intertwining or something. So more prosaically, this means that the symmetries map onto each other. Okay. Now you may be a little bit puzzled about this word asymptotic in the context of ADS. So in a gravity theory, because of diffeomorphism invariance, the space-time symmetry generators, such as the Hamiltonian or the angular momentum, are always local integrals at the spatial boundary. So that's not true in quantum field theory, right? As we discussed last time, in quantum field theory, the Hamiltonian is an integral of a local density over all of space. But in gravity, it's an integral only at the boundary, okay? And so I could give a whole lecture about why diffeomorphism invariance requires the space-time symmetry generators to be integrals only at the boundary. But roughly speaking, the intuition is that it's like Gauss's law, right? So in electromagnetism, you know that you can learn the total charge, electric charge in space by measuring the electric flux at infinity. Okay, so that's a local integral at infinity. And the fact that you can measure the charge anywhere in space just by measuring something at the boundary is a consequence of the gauge symmetry of electrodynamics. And similarly in gravity, You can measure the energy or the angular momentum just by measuring something at infinity, just like in Gauss's law. And so that's what asymptotic means here. Okay. So in particular, this means that the Hamiltonians have the same spectrum in both theories. The Hamiltonian maps from one maps to the Hamiltonian of the other. So you can, they have to have the same energy levels, which is a strong statement, right? I mean, that's not just a consequence of having the symmetry. It's saying not only do the symmetries have to line up, but the representations of the symmetry have to line up, which is a very dynamical statement. Now, unfortunately, in general, this is almost all I can say about the dictionary without thinking some more about the answer to question two, because other than the asymptotic symmetries, we don't know too many observables that are sort of general observables of quantum gravity, even in the regime where it's very strongly quantum and not well described by Einstein or anything else. Okay, so we have to think a little bit about how things might work in the semi-classical case before we can come up with more lines in the dictionary. But first, any questions about the symmetries in general?
So to clarify, which symmetries actually map on one another?
Yeah.
You've been discussing the philomorphism invariants in on the part of the general relativity, and also that in GR we have local integrals over the boundary, and then in QFT we have the global integrals. And but obviously the symmetries are different in the two field theories. So how exactly? So which symmetries and which don't? And so how does the diffeomorphism invariants dealt with as a symmetry, or how is it coped with?
Well, it's really an asymptotic symmetry, right? So in the dual CFT, so let's first discuss space-time symmetries, then we can think about internal symmetries later. So for space-time symmetries, in the dual CFT, we know what the space-time symmetry group is. It's this conformal group that we just discussed, okay? So it turns out, I didn't have time to explain it, but this conformal group is also the group of isometries of this AdS solution, okay? So those are the same. On the other hand, of course, the AdS solution is not the only solution around, right? We also have states where, like this one, right, which have less symmetry. But because of this asymptotic notion of the diffeomorphisms, you actually get the full symmetry of this AdS. It just gets promoted to an asymptotic symmetry that acts on all of the states in the asymptotically AdS spacetime. So it's just like in flat space, right? The Poincaré group acts on as a symmetry, as an asymptotic symmetry group of general relativity with asymptotically flat boundary conditions, even though, you know, most of the states don't have full Poincaré symmetry. Instead, they just transform in representations of Poincaré symmetry. And so that matches onto this conformal symmetry of the dual CFT. You can also have internal global symmetries of the dual CFT, and those map onto gauge symmetries in the bulk, which again are asymptotic symmetries. Like I just gave an example in electromagnetism, right? You could have a U1 gauge field in the bulk. Its charge would be the electric flux in infinity, and we interpret that as the charge of a global symmetry in the dual CFT. I'm not sure if that helps or not.
In chat, we have three questions.
I think there are some questions in the chat. Yeah, so maybe Marco is the next.
Yes, Daniel, just a thing. So the fact that the symmetries match between the bulk and the boundary, is it peculiar to the SFT? Because I remember that, for example, in AdS holography, you have enhancements of symmetries between boundary and bulk. So I was wondering if the SFT is peculiar about this and why it is the case.
Well, I would say anytime you have a duality, the symmetries have to be the same on both sides, because you're just talking about the same theory in two different languages.
OK, I see. So maybe in that cases there are some subtleties that there is not reality, but like I mean the dictionary is like an incomplete or something, right?
Yeah, I mean there's an issue that different people mean different things by the word duality, but here the duality we're talking about is an exact duality.
I see.
Yeah, sometimes condensed matter physicists use the word to mean something else, which is less concrete.
Right.
But here I mean an exact equivalence.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, Vincenzo.
Yes, a very general question. In a certain sense, symmetries in contemporary physics make a job similar to differential equation on in other parts of physics. And we know that many times differential equation in very different realm of phenomena are very similar. For instance, Schrödinger equation and Planck-Fock equation are very similar from a mathematical point of view, but it is not very informative for us. It is only a structural analogy without very important aspect. Why here this equivalence is physically relevant for us? What is more than a simple analogy of form or structure?
Yeah, so I think we have to distinguish between saying that the symmetry groups are the same and saying that the representations are the same. So saying the symmetry groups are the same is not a very deep statement. I mean, lots of things have the same symmetry groups. But saying that the states transform in the same representations is really saying that the theories are the same. Because in particular, the symmetry includes the Hamiltonian. So we're saying that the Hilbert spaces have the same, you know, the Hilbert spaces are isomorphic and they have the same Hamiltonian.
So probably under this symmetry, there is a sort of physical reality that is the same represented in two different perspectives, something of this kind.
Yeah, this may be a little more clear once I talk a bit more about the dictionary and you see that there's kind of a natural relationship between the observables. I mean, of course, it's true that if I want to, you know, I can embed the standard model of particle physics into the simple harmonic oscillator Hilbert space if I want to in some stupid way, right? You know, because they're both infinite and, you know, everything infinite is the same somehow. That would be kind of a dumb thing to do. But here the mapping is quite natural. We'll see that there are simple relationships between the observables. So you're not just kind of doing some weird thing. Yeah, maybe Sakshi.
Hi, so I have a clarification question about the isomorphism.
Yeah.
Maybe I'm a little confused. Do we know what all of the degrees of freedom are in the conformal field theory that we can construct the Hilbert space, or do we still need some kind of indirect way, like finding the area of the boundary? And if so, are we assuming that the dimensionality is also is always finite?
In specific examples, we know, right? Like in this n=4 super Yang Mills example, we know exactly what the boundary Hilbert space is and what degrees of freedom are. And it's infinite, I would say. Yeah, both of these things are gonna be infinite dimensional.
Oh, they're both gonna be infinite dimensional. Okay.
Yeah, yeah, usually quantum field theory is infinite dimensional and quantum gravity and AdS should also be infinite dimensional. You know, you can have black holes of arbitrarily large size, for example.
Okay. Okay, so then I guess then maybe later when you talk about holography, what exactly the redundancy means when both spaces are infinite would be helpful.
Well, I'm not sure that I would say that. Yeah, I think redundancy is maybe not quite the right word. It's just that there's this surprising equivalence between theories that seem to live in different numbers of space-time dimensions. That's what's meant by holography. So this is kind of an example of holography.
Okay.
I didn't try to motivate holography as a general principle here, although one can. Instead, I'm just trying to familiarize you with the best understood example of holography.
Okay. Okay, so we're not necessarily talking about redundancy of degrees of freedom, but just that we can map every state from one space to another of a higher dimension.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Okay, and then Siddharth?
Yeah, I think the questions earlier addressed several of the concerns, but just to be super clear, so the set of symmetries and the CFT fully fixes the Hamiltonian on the CFT.
No, to be clear, when you say the set of symmetries, you have to be careful. If you just mean the groups as subtract groups, then it doesn't fix the Hamiltonian. But if you mean the representations, then it does by definition, because the Hamiltonian is part of the symmetry group. And so to say the representation is telling you the energy levels.
Ah, okay. And right, so the, yeah, so if you just take a simple, yeah, so if you just take like finite dimensional Hilbert spaces, then, right, you have any two finite dimensional Hilbert spaces of the same dimension will be isomorphic, but that's too general here. So you're sort of talking about,
But this intertwining property is strong. I mean, this intertwining property is the stronger one, right? Like, so, yeah, I mean, both Hilbert spaces are infinite dimensional. So constructing an isomorphism is easy, but constructing an isomorphism that does this is not easy.
Okay.
Okay, maybe we should go on to question two, and then I think this will all feel more concrete. So I'm going to give a definition. So I'll say that a CFTD has a semi-classical dual. And so here I'm answering Enrico's question from before. Okay, and then this definition is going to be a bit of a mouthful, so you're going to have to be patient. We're going to have to probably extend it up onto the next column, but I'll start writing it here. So if there exists a finite set OI of primary operators, so this is why I had to define primary before. And a bulk effective action, it's a local effective action, S of phi I and lambda, where this is a cutoff, and these are bulk fields. And in particular, there's a metric g mu nu, which is contained in the list of bulk fields, such that, and now we're going to go over to the top here, if we look at the bulk path integral over these bulk fields, with this effective action, phi I with a cutoff, and the cutoff has to be there because this action is going to be non-normalizable, then there's a set of bulk observables, which I'll define in a minute, which I'll call O bulk I1 of X1 to OIN bulk of XN, such that the expectation value of these observables is equal to the CFT expectation value of these primaries. So these O's are taken from this list of primary, finite list of primary operators, OIN of XN, computed in the expectation value in the ground state in the dual CFT. Okay, so this is saying that there's some bulk path integral based on a local action with a finite number of fields that reproduces the CFT correlators. But actually that's too much because that won't be true. So we have to say that this is true only to all orders in the small quantity 1 over L times lambda. Okay. Then I have to define, moreover, I have to define these O bulks. So let me do that. So O I bulk, which depends on a boundary point. So I can label that by a time and a place on the sphere, is defined to be the limit SR goes to infinity of R to the delta I, where this delta I is the scaling dimension of this primary operator OI. So remember I said every primary operator has a scaling dimension. And then I put phi I of R T and omega. Okay. So that's the end of the definition. I apologize for the length of it. This last equality here is these days often called the extrapolate dictionary. Okay, so what it says is that if I take a bulk field, so let me draw a picture. So if I take a bulk field, right, in this cylinder, and I extrapolate it to the boundary by taking R going to infinity, then I get a primary operator OI in the dual CFT. That's what this equation says, and that works to all orders in this expansion parameter of the of 1 over L times the cutoff in the bulk. What is phi? Where is there a phi? You mean the phi I here? These are bulk fields, if that answers the question. So this bulk effective action is an action that depends on some fields, including a metric. And so this phi I is just I runs over the set of bulk fields. So what this definition is basically saying is that any CFT which obeys this definition will be dual to a gravitational theory that has reasonable particle physics, meaning that it has an effective action which is local with some cutoff scale which is high compared to the AdS radius. So in particular, in order for this statement to be non-trivial, I want this quantity to be small, which means I want the cutoff scale to be high compared to the AdS radius. So just to make this a little bit more concrete, so there are two sort of canonical examples of this. So this extrapolate dictionary kind of gives you a pairing between this finite set of primary operators and the set of bulk fields that appear in the effective action, okay? And two natural examples of this pairing. So one is you have the bulk field, which is the metric, okay? And this pairing relates it to the energy momentum tensor in the dual CFT. So that's one example of this pairing. Another example is if you have a gauge field in the bulk, like a U1 gauge field, then that's corresponds to a conserved current in the dual CFT. Okay, so these are examples of the extrapolate dictionary, but more generally, any field in the bulk should, in this bulk effective description, should be dual to some primary CFT operator. Okay, so this is what we mean by saying that a CFT has a semi-classical dual. Okay, now Enrico may immediately complain because this was a question, right? And you don't get to answer a question with a definition, right? So what I did was I asked a question, and then what I really did here was I just sharpened the question. I said, this is what I really want, but we still are left with the question of, okay, but which are the CFTs where this definition actually holds, right? Which are the CFTs which indeed have semi-classical duals? Okay. So, so there are some supersymmetric conformal field theories, such as this n equals 4 theory, where you can show fairly explicitly, although I wouldn't say completely rigorously, that they obey this definition, okay? Just by being good at supersymmetry and being good at conformal field theory. More generally, there is a set of conformal field theories which are called gapped large N theories, which we expect should all obey this. There are sort of arguments that any conformal field theory in that class, which includes this n equals four, but also other examples, should obey this definition of having a semi-classical dual. But in general, we don't know the full set of CFTs that obey this. We just have some examples. Okay. And so, but the key, maybe the key thing is this extrapolate dictionary, which kind of shows you that there's a very natural connection between the fields in the bulk and the, these primary operators in the dual CFT, which, you know, so it's not some totally arbitrary thing. All right, so any questions about that?
Yeah, maybe. So you were asking which are the CFTs with the gravity dual. What about the converse? Which are the gravity theories with the CFT dual? I mean, you have some restriction there.
Yeah, so we actually, in some sense, think it's all of them, right? So I guess the idea here, although I can't prove it, is that this should be the only way of doing quantum gravity in EDS.
I see. So also topological theories and all of that.
Yeah, that should all, right. I mean, yeah, if the gravity is topological, then usually what you expect is the boundary theory will be also topological. So a topological field theory is like a, right, so we, you know, it's an even more crazy set of symmetries, right? So conformal theory, field theories have, are Poincaré invariant theories with more conformal symmetry. And topological theories are even worse. So then they have arbitrary, they're symmetric under arbitrary diffeomorphisms. So they're like, that's like a special case of conformal field theory. Yeah.
Primary? What does mean the primary operators?
So that was this thing I said before. So primary operators are these operators that transform simply under the conformal symmetry.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah, that's why I gave this definition, just because I had to mention it later. Mm-hmm. So maybe now let me get back a little bit to this question that Manas Visser was asking earlier. So I've sometimes encountered some confusion about whether the AdS CFT correspondence is exact or approximate. Okay. So the right statement is that the correspondence itself is exact. And in fact, it's almost kind of trivially so if you view the CFT as the definition of the gravity theory. I mean, if it's the definition, then a definition by definition is exact. Okay. But this requirement that the theory has a semi-classical dual is an approximate notion, right? And the approximateness of it showed up in this statement here where I said to all orders in 1 over L times lambda. Okay. That's an approximate condition. Okay. As we will learn more next time, right? I mean, when I say all to all orders in this, one thing in particular that I mean by that is that this n, this number of operators that I'm allowed to insert here, is order one, you know, in terms of this small parameter. I'm not allowed to sort of have numbers of fields which are so large that they grow with the, as this parameter becomes small. And so that puts a restricted regime of validity on when this equation should be true. This equation is true approximately, and moreover, it's only true in states where you act on the vacuum with not too many of these O's. Okay. There is actually a stronger statement where you allow this to be true, where you demand that this is true around arbitrary backgrounds, which also should be true, and I think is a consequence of this, although I haven't managed to prove it. Ultimately, you just have to accept that this bulk description in terms of S of phi and lambda, this local effective action, is an approximate and emergent description. Okay, and so when we say that the bulk in AdS CFT is emergent, what we mean is that this description with S of phi is only good in certain states and only to some finite precision. Okay. It's not a good description in all states, and in some states, it's a very bad description. Okay. And so the fundamental description is the description in terms of the CFT, and then just sometimes we have this approximate emergent description in terms of the bulk. Okay. So maybe now Manus, I'll ask first if he wants to make any comments or ask any more questions about this, since he brought it up earlier, if he's still here.
Manus had to go to put his child to bed, so he asked me to, if you brought this up, he asked me to give you his regrets.
Okay, well, all right. Yeah, I sympathize to that. I have similar issues. Anyone else then want to ask questions or comments about this?
I just want to clarify the extrapolate dictionary.
Yeah.
So, because on the right hand side, we have this limit to infinity. Is it correct to say that it only concerns bulk fields that live, you know, close to the boundary?
Yeah, that's correct, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, and in fact, that's kind of, it's related to the thing Eric was asking about before. So, you know, if we consider larger and larger black holes, then we kind of understand these bulk fields less and less deep into the bulk. So the way the order of limit works is that you kind of have to decide which states you're interested in, and then that tells you sort of how large R has to be before you can use this formula. The limiting operator we think should make sense in all states, so it shouldn't have a restricted regime of validity. Just for bigger states, you have to go further out towards the limit before you converge to the right answer. Other questions?
Sorry, can I ask a question? I just have a general question about AdS CFT.
Yeah.
So there are many dualities in string theory, and there are many things that we know, theorems about, for example, field theories and somehow quantum gravity theories included in string theory. But why we are, I think they're not the same as AdS-CFT. You know, we just extend AdS-CFT as a theorem of a string theory to generalize it for whole quantum gravity theories. Why we cannot do this to other, for example, theorems or dualities in string theory, or to generalize them to whole quantum gravity theories? Thank you.
Right, so most of the dualities in string theory relate gravitational situations in string theory to other gravitational situations in string theory. So they're relating something that we don't understand that well to something else that we also don't understand that well. And so there isn't this desire, there isn't this desire to kind of turn it into its own thing independent of string theory, because they're sort of intrinsically stringy on both sides. But somehow in this case with n equals four, the strings kind of disappear in the dual description. You just have this quantum field theory, that somehow is equivalent to string theory in the other description. And so, I think it's the only example I know where it's the duality between something with gravity and something without gravity. I should just say that.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, there was a question to repeat what I mean by being approximate. Yeah, so when I said, it's here when I said to all orders in this parameter, which I said should be small. So that means that you should understand this equation as a perturbative equation. It's an equation where you expand in this parameter, because that's we only know how to make sense of this perturbatively, right? This is a non-renormalizable theory. It has some effective action with a cutoff. And we really, in things like that, we really think about them as effective theories where we're expanding in units of energy divided by the cutoff. And so we're kind of trying to match order by order in that expansion. By going to other backgrounds, you can match some things that are non-perturbative, such as black hole entropy, which we'll talk about in a minute. But there's still, whatever you compute, there's still always this inherent ambiguity, just by virtue of doing perturbation theory.
Does one allow to superpose, sort of very different geometries in the book.
If you superpose an order one number of them, then yes. So you can have a superposition of having a planet and not having a planet, and that's fine. But if you try to, you know, superpose, you know, all the microstates of some black hole or something, then that can get you into trouble. But that has to do with this restriction. Maybe I should say more explicit. So I want this n to be of order this small thing to the zero. And so as long as I make that restriction, then it's fine.
But I mean, like, if I superpose one background with another background, that does it.
Yeah, that's fine. So superposing having the vacuum with a planet is what you said, and that's fine.
Okay.
We've had years of pushing the limit. I'm trying to give you the most sort of easy to digest version of this. I mean, we've gotten good at kind of pushing the limits on this and seeing how far we can get. So there are things that are stronger than this are true, but I'm just trying to tell you the simple thing.
Sorry, I missed this little bit. So you have this, you wrote G mu nu implies and is implied by d mu nu, or is equivalent to. So yeah. You're saying that the energy momentum tensor of the conformal field theory just is the metric in the ADS, or? Sorry.
Yeah, no, I mean that in this extrapolated dictionary, right? If you take this phi I to be the bulk metric,
mm-hmm.
okay, and then do this extrapolation procedure, then the claim is the operator that you'll get in the dual, you know, in the dual CFT, according to this equation,
mm-hmm.
will be the energy momentum tensor of the dual CFT. And similarly, and, if you extrapolate a bulk gauge field to the boundary, then you get a current surf current for global symmetry in the boundaries theory.
Right. Okay. So I guess I'm not super used to thinking of the metric as a field, but I guess it makes sense. Yeah.
That's quantum gravity.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. So that's all I was going to say, actually, about the general structure of the correspondence. Now I was going to talk a bit more about how black holes work in this correspondence. So the key thing to know about black holes in ADS is related to what Eric was getting at the beginning, which is that since ADS is a box, so black holes will evaporate, they'll produce Hawking radiation just as they would in flat space. But for a black hole in ADS, there's a new thing that can happen. So let me try to separate the discussion off here. So if you have a black hole in ADS, right, what it does is it kind of eats up some piece in the center of the space. Okay. This black hole will be spitting out Hawking radiation, as we discussed last time. But now there's a new thing that can happen, which is that the Hawking radiation can go out to the boundary, bounce off, and fall back into the black hole. Okay. So at least if the black hole is big enough, then it falls back in before the mass of the black hole decreases appreciably. And so then the black hole actually doesn't evaporate. It just sits here sort of in equilibrium with a gas of radiation outside of the black hole. Okay. And so that's the main difference about black holes in ADS, is that big ADS black holes don't evaporate. Okay. They just kind of sit there in equilibrium with their own Hawking radiation, like a bathtub or something. Nonetheless, you can still go through the analog of Hawking's calculation using the ADS Schwarzschild metric that I wrote down before. You can work out the temperature. You can work out the temperature that the black hole radiates. So in this picture, that'll be the temperature of the heat bath that it's eventually in equilibrium with. And what you get is that the temperature is now d minus 2 plus d times the Schwarzschild radius of the black hole over the AdS radius quantity squared, divided by 4 pi r times the Schwarzschild radius, where I'm defining the Schwarzschild radius so that this function s that we saw before is zero at the Schwarzschild radius. So when we looked at the black hole metric over here, right, I had this function f of r here. So yeah, you might naively think that this thing here should be the Schwarzschild radius, but that's actually not where this thing vanishes, right? The Schwarzschild radius is where this thing vanishes. That's the location of the horizon. And then we can also work out the entropy, right? So once we have the temperature, we can integrate to find the entropy as before. And that will just be as before, we'll get omega d minus one. So that's the volume of the d minus one dimensional sphere, the Schwarzschild radius to the d minus one power divided by 4g. So in other words, that'll just be area over 4g. Okay. So not too different than before. In particular, we can study these equations in limit where in the situation where the black hole is big. So in particular, if RS is much bigger than L, right? So that's the regime where this piece of the spacetime that the black hole has eaten up is sort of quite close to the boundary in some sense. It's eating up a lot of the space. So it's really just the Hawking radiation is kind of getting reflected back in very fast. Then we can solve for the Schwarzschild radius in that limit, and it's just RS to the D is of order GM. So that comes from setting F to zero and figuring out what RS is. So then we can write the entropy S GM to the D minus one over D divided by G, which we can also write as g to the minus one over d times m to the d minus one over d. Okay. So that's just some estimate for the entropy of a big black hole in AdS, okay, where I'm not keeping track of order one factors, just looking at the scaling of things with g and m. And so what we're going to do now is we're going to try to match this to the conformal field theory. So this will be kind of a test of this idea of AdS CFT, you know, being true also for high energy states, maybe not just near the vacuum, something like that. Okay. So very qualitatively, it kind of makes sense, right? So if you have a big black hole and it doesn't evaporate, you just have some thermal bath sitting here. And indeed, if you heat up the CFT to some high temperature, right, the CFT is also living in a box. It's living in the sphere. So it should just be in some thermal state, but let's try to make that more quantitative. Okay, so we can try to compare to the CFT. Okay, so for any CFT at high temperature, we should expect that the entropy should go like the number of degrees of freedom per site, or if you like, you can think of this as the number of fields. Times the temperature to the d minus one. Okay, that's just by essentially dimensional analysis tells you the power of the temperature, and then sort of intuition from lattice systems tells you that it should always be proportional to the number of degrees of freedom as well, since if you just have more degrees of freedom, you have more entropy at when you're in thermal equilibrium. And similarly, the energy in thermal equilibrium should go like the number of degrees of freedom now times t to the d. Okay, so again, the t to the d is dimensional analysis. The t to the d and the n du f is just the number of degrees of freedom. You know, the thermal energy should be proportional to the number of degrees of freedom. General fact about local systems at finite temperature. So then we can combine these to tell us that S should go like the number of degrees of freedom times E over the number of degrees of freedom to the D minus one over D, which we can rewrite as the number of degrees of freedom to the minus 1 over d times the energy to the d minus 1 over d. Okay. And now this is the moment of truth. We want to compare these two equations. Okay. And so you see that, well, mass is energy and energy is mass. So it's good. The power of the energy works out between the two. And moreover, the power of the coupling will work out, provided, I wonder if I made a typo here. I think I did. I think maybe this should be plus if I did it right. I think this should be plus here, maybe. Let's just check. So I have, it should be 1 minus d minus 1 over d, which is d minus d minus 1, or plus 1 over d, which is 1 over d. Okay, so indeed it's a typo, this should be plus. And so you see these are going to agree provided that the number of degrees of freedom goes like 1 over g, okay? That's what we need in order for the scaling of the entropy of the dual CFT and the entropy of the black hole to match at high temperature. Okay. So this relationship is sort of natural in general. If you expect that the gravity should emerge from some kind of saddle point description in the dual CFT, but in fact, in specific examples such as n equals 4 super Yang nulls, you can just check this, right? So this is true in n equals 4 and also in other examples where we can check it. It's true in all examples where we can check it. And so this is kind of a fairly powerful check that the thermodynamics of a conformal field theory at high temperature has the right thermodynamics to match onto the thermodynamics of a big black hole in AdS, at least at the level of scaling. In fact, in special cases, you can do more than the scaling. You can even match the order one coefficient sitting here to the order one coefficient sitting there. That's more specialized. You either have to be in, you either need the CFT to be in 1+1 dimensions, or you need to have zounds of supersymmetry to enable you to do the computation. Okay, any questions about that?
So if I understand this correctly, it looks like kind of the more complex the CFT is, the weaker gravity gets. Is that right?
Yeah, that's correct. That's correct.
Is there an intuitive way to understand why that is?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, basically, yeah, so this is when I said earlier that the CFTs that obey this semi-classical rule should be gapped large N CFTs, that's kind of what I meant.
Okay.
Yeah, somehow if you have, in quantum field theory, if you have a large number of degrees of freedom, it tends to introduce a new kind of semi-classical behavior. And this goes back to ideas of Wilson and Atuft in the early 1970s. Somehow just it having the number of degrees of freedom be large allows you to reorganize the degrees of freedom in terms of some effective degrees of freedom, sometimes called master fields. In Atuft has this, in gauge theory, there's this story about how gauge theories at large N are dominated only by planar diagrams. And so that large N counting is kind of how you confirm this relationship directly in N equals 4 just by, you know, so you can just look, for example, at graviton-graviton scattering, right? That's the way to measure G Newton. And you can just see that it involves the power of N where it's SUN gauge theory. So yeah, essentially this N DOF somehow in N equals 4, it's basically N squared where N is the N of SUN of the gauge group. You need some parameter to be large in order to suppress, you know, the Planck scale relative to the AdS scale, and having the large number of degrees of freedom just seems to be the right thing. I mean, maybe the most intuitive explanation is the one I just gave, you know, that somehow it makes the black hole entropy big.
That kind of makes sense, but I'm going to chew on that. Yeah. Thank you.
Uh-huh.
Can I just ask you just maybe a curiosity, because before you were saying that the relation between n and 1 over g, you're saying something like this is very natural if you think of gravity as some kind of subtle point of the CFT, right? So I wanted to ask you maybe if you could expand a bit more on how we can recover maybe the gravity configurations from how do they appear in the CFT's path integral, maybe, or something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, I mean, that's hard to answer in general. Mm-hmm. You know, there are some very low dimensional examples where we've managed to do that in the context of, say, this SYK model and Jacquive-Teitelbaum gravity. But yeah, in higher dimensions, it's kind of more of a hope. Like, you know, there's something called, so with large N field theories, they're the ones people usually talk about are like called vector models and matrix models. And we kind of know how to do that for vector models, but those are dual to weird gravity theories that have lots of higher spin particles. So there we kind of know how to do it. But for the ones that are dual to Einstein gravity, those are matrix models. And somehow working out the large N semi-classical approximation to a matrix model is a long and unsolved problem. You know, people have been trying for decades.
But so, at least in the low dimensional examples where, as you say, we know how it works. So how does it work there at least? So it's actually a subtle point of the CFT.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. So somehow what you have to do is you integrate in new fields into the CFT, which somehow decouple the old fields. Then you integrate out the old fields, and you're left with some action in terms of the new fields, which has an explicit power of this n degree of freedom in front. And so then you can do a semi-classical approximation.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, to try to explain that in detail, we'd have to go through some examples. It probably would take too long.
I see. Is there anything that maybe I could check from that?
You mean what we could look? Well, I mean, so in those low-dimensional examples, people try to use that. I mean, yeah, there are things you can check. So yeah, there are a lot of papers where people try to learn from that picture. Yeah, unfortunately, those tricks don't seem to work. It seems too hard to make that to work in higher dimensions.
I see. Thanks.
Yeah. Carol has a question.
Yes. So this morning, during Eric's class, we discussed the subtle issues of describing black hole evaporation, in the sense that apart from having Hawking radiation, the mass of the black hole is deduced. And so as it turns out that this description of it is difficult in semi-classical gravity, I wonder whether the approach now taken in the AdS CFT correspondence does shed us any light on it or provide any satisfying answer on how, say, the ADM mass couples to entropy generation at the horizon.
Well, I'm not sure that, I'm sorry, I wasn't in Eric's lecture, so I don't know exactly what you're referring to, but I will say that there is a fairly general connection between black hole and mass and ADM energy, which was developed by Wald and collaborators. Somebody, maybe Manus, was referring to it in earlier lectures. It's definitely the case that whenever I say energy here, I mean the ADM energy. You know, and that's one of the many things that I didn't have time to explain. I mean, it's something I've thought about a lot. In fact, hopefully in another few weeks, I'm going to put out some 90-page paper about it. But I don't think that there's a fundamental confusion there. You just, you know, because gravity is diff invariant, you have to learn to live with the energy being defined at infinity. So, you know, when you talk about the mass of the black hole decreasing in time, you kind of have to formulate that a little more precisely. Okay. There were two other things I wanted to talk about today. Let's see how far we can get. Neither of them is particularly, we're mostly done, but two things that are worth discussing. So I just first wanted to mention very briefly, so this is kind of the situation when we have a black hole that we formed out of collapse. You could also ask about what, okay, we started with this AdS Schwarzschild wormhole with the two geometries connected. And what's the CFT interpretation of that? Okay, so it's a natural question, and it's a natural question with a natural answer. So let's just briefly discuss the answer. So the full AdS Schwarzschild so the Penrose diagram of it looks like this. I'm not very good at vertical lines. Let me try again. So it's a bit like the flat space Schwarzschild, except instead of having this null infinities over here, we just have this AdS boundary, which is a vertical line. Okay. And so you can see there are two AdS boundaries. There's a left AdS boundary and a right AdS boundary. And so if you want to give this a CFT interpretation, it has to be as a state that lives in the Hilbert space of two copies of the dual CFT, or if you like, the CFT living on two spheres. And in fact, there's a simple picture for what the state should be, at least if you adopt what's the so-called Hartle-Hawking state here. So this is a geometry, so you have to say the state of the quantum field, so you take the Hartle-Hawking state. And so then in the dual CFT, this is described by what we call the thermofield double state. Which is an entangled state between the left and the right CFTs, where now these are energy eigenstates. Okay, and so this is actually quite similar to the Rindler picture of the state that we had last time. You have some entanglement between the left CFT over here and the right CFT over here. They're entangled in this way. And so you can see if you look at either the left or the right density matrix, right, you just get the thermal density matrix. Okay. So from either the right side or the left side, this just looks thermal, which is this picture that we had over here of the black hole, right? But then that thermality is all actually explained by the entanglement between the two sides, which is what leads to this wormhole, which is connecting them. Okay. And so this is everybody's favorite state to think about in AdS CFT. There are lots of fun games that you can play with this state. And we're gonna use it for one thing in a minute. Okay, that's all I was gonna say about it. So any questions about the thermofield double and the full AdS Schwarzschild geometry?
This looks a lot like the argument you gave yesterday for the entanglement of the ground state of field theories. Is that just accidental?
No, it's not accidental. That's essential, yes. So, no, and in fact, the justification for this formula, which I didn't justify that formula, and I'm not going to justify this one either, but they both come from thinking about Euclidean gravity path angles. And this entanglement, you know, it has roughly the same interpretation that the modes over here have to be entangled with the modes over here in order for the geometry to be smooth, and they have to be entangled in just this way. We've just translated that statement, which was a statement in the bulk, into a statement in the dual CFTs, so that now this is very well defined. Okay. All right, so on to the last topic, which is holographic entropy formulas. Okay, so far the dictionary we've discussed has been between fairly simple observables. The Hamiltonian, the angular momentum, correlation functions of local operators, things like that. There are also some things we know about more sort of information theoretic observables. And in particular, something that we like a lot is if you pick some spatial subregion of the boundary CFT. So like say, here's a time slice, and then we just pick out, say, this region here and call it R, then we can ask what is the von Neumann entropy of the CFT state on the region R? Okay, that's a natural thing that we can ask about. And remember, in quantum field theory, the Hilbert space is a tensor product of the degrees of freedom in R and the degrees of freedom in its complement. So we can reduce the state onto just R and then compute its von Neumann entropy. And something we've learned over the last 15 years is that, this seems from the CFT point of view, this is a fairly complicated observable, right? You have to know the state of the CFT and then compute minus trace of rho log rho, right? This is minus trace of rho R log rho R. So that seems like a hopeless kind of thing to compute, at least if you're starting in the CFT, you know, you're in some strongly coupled quantum field theory. It seems hard to compute this. There are some special cases where we can, but usually we can't. But actually there's a formula for how to compute this in the bulk using just gravitational physics. And so that formula is the last thing that I'm going to explain here. I'm going to do it in two steps. So there's kind of there's a baby initial version of the formula, and then there's the grown-up version of the formula. But we'll start with the baby version. Okay, so here's a claim. So let rho be a CFTD state. Which is dual to an approximately classical a bulk geometry with time reversal symmetry. And let sigma be a bulk time slice, which is a T invariant. So it's invariant under time reversal. Okay. Moreover, let R contained in the boundary of sigma be a boundary spatial subregion. Okay, then, okay, here's the claim. S of rho r is equal to the minimum over some surfaces gamma that I'll say what we minimize over in a sec, of the area of gamma divided by 4g. Okay. And so here, gamma is all a d minus one dimensional surfaces such that, so there are two requirements. So we want the boundary of gamma to be equal to the boundary of R. So this is called anchored to R. And moreover, we want there to exist H such that the boundary of H is equal to gamma union R. Okay, and so H is a bulk region. And so the minimal gamma we'll call gamma R, and it's sometimes called the RT surface. Okay, so I apologize, that was a lot to say and write out. Let me draw a picture, which should hopefully make this more intuitive.
Dan, when you say time slice, you mean slice in the technical sense of a closed achronal surface without edge? Or are you speaking more loosely?
I mean a Cauchy slice.
Okay.
Yeah, I just didn't want to say that because, I don't know, maybe you define Cauchy slice in your lecture, but I wasn't assuming everyone knows what Cauchy slice is. So let me draw a picture of what this looks like. Let me make the picture bigger. Okay, So here, this disk is some time slice of the bulk. This will be my Cauchy slice sigma, okay? And moreover, let's take R to be this boundary interval here. So here we're doing, so I'm drawing the picture for AdS3 CFT2. So in CFT2, space is just a circle. So a subregion of a circle, so that circle is this yellow circle here, and then the subregion, a spatial subregion in the boundary is just, say, just this blue one here, okay? So then this surfaces gamma that we extremize over, so let me draw a few possibilities, right? So here's some gamma like that, you know, here's another gamma like that, right? So when we're doing ADS3 or CFT2, right, then D is 2, so gamma is one-dimensional, and so one-dimensional surface is a line. So the anchored requirement says the endpoints of the line have to be the same as the endpoints of R. And the homologous requirement means that there has to, you know, each of these has to be the boundary of some region that it's, where its other boundary is R. So that's true for these. In particular, let's say the minimal one, so it's a surface of minimal area. So here it's a line. So a line of minimal area is always a geodesic. So it'll just be something like that. Okay, this will be gamma R. And then this H is like just this shaded region here, okay? So we have this sort of competition over all these lines whose endpoints are the endpoints of R, and we find the one of minimal length, and then we divide by its area or its length here by 4G, and that gives the entropy of the boundary region, okay? So it's not as bad as it looks. It's actually a pretty simple prescription. So any questions about this definition before we interpret it a little bit? So this is called the Ryu-Takinagi formula. Proposed in 2006. So maybe one comment I should make is that this, the Bekenstein-Hawking formula for the entropy of a black hole is a special case of this formula. So this is a very powerful formula. So for example, if we consider this, we could consider this thermofield double state that we discussed a minute ago. So that has, two ADS boundaries, right, that are connected by a wormhole. It should be symmetric, but it's not very symmetric the way I drew it. So like here's the right CFT, and here's the left CFT, right? And this is the wormhole that's connecting them. So so this is the spatial slice of the wormhole connecting them, right? So if we take our, that was awful. I mean CFT left over here. I don't mean, there's not two CFT rights. That's crazy. So then we can take R to just be equal to the whole CFT right, okay? And so so for the whole CFT right, we computed the state before, it's just the thermal state, okay? So the von Neumann entropy of the right boundary is just the thermal entropy of the CFT at inverse temperature beta, okay? But now we can apply the rule, we can look for this Ryu-Takinagi surface, right? And what it ends up being is it just ends up being a little circle here that's wrapping the horizon. So here the region R has no boundary, right? It's just this circle here. And this gamma also has no boundary. So the anchored requirement is satisfied. And the homology requirement is also satisfied. This gamma R here is homologous to the right boundary by this piece of the wormhole that's in between them. So this gamma is an allowed gamma. And moreover, you can kind of see it's the allowed gamma of minimal area, right? But then the Ryu-Takinagi formula then just tells you that S of rho R equals the area of the horizon over 4G, which is the Bekenstein-Hawking formula. Okay. So this formula knows the Bekenstein-Hawking formula, but it knows a lot more because I can apply it to any region of the boundary and in any state which obeys the requirements we said. And this will still give you the entropy. So it's a much stronger statement than the Bekenstein-Hawking formula. Any questions, concerns, comments? Siddharth has a question.
Yeah, this is a broader question. I guess at some point we shifted from thinking about the relation between the AdS and CFT theories as just a correspondence, like a mathematical correspondence, to thinking about the CFT as really living on the boundary of the bulk AdS. Now, this is slightly different from ordinary ways in which we think about the boundary of some volume, right? Because usually the degrees of freedom inside the bulk can interact with the degrees of freedom on the boundary. But here, they're like the same degrees
so
of
freedom. When you say it lives on the boundary, you have to be careful. It's not living on the boundary in the sense that there are signals that propagate between the CFT and the bulk, right? Like, no, it's just, when you say you live on the boundary, I just mean that the space that it lives on is isomorphic to the boundary of AdS. But it's really dual to the whole thing. It's dual to everything that's going on throughout the AdS.
Well, but we can separately think of the boundary of the AdS, right? Because the AdS.
Yeah, that's right. But there's no, from the AdS picture, there's nothing living there, right? It's just some boundary. There are some boundary conditions, you know, stuff that goes there just bounces off. Yeah. Okay. So I presented this as a claim, but by this point, I think it's believed by pretty much everybody. It has passed many checks. There's also some kind of derivation for it, although the derivation has some fine print that you have to read before you decide if you believe it. However, it also has some shortcomings. The obvious ones are that, why on earth did we restrict to time reversal invariant states, right? Like, that's crazy, right? Most states are not time reversal invariant. So why should we have such a silly restriction in such a general formula? So that's complaint number one. Complaint number two is that this formula is essentially classical, right? Is it approximately classical? This formula on the right here refers only to classical notions. And so you don't really know what to do, say, like if you're in a superposition of geometries, like somebody asked, or what if there are fields in the bulk that have a large entropy? I mean, shouldn't that also contribute to the entropy here? But I don't see that in the formula, right? So somehow to properly include quantum mechanics and also to get rid of the time reversal symmetry, we're going to have to fix this formula up a little bit. Okay. And so I'll close by just writing what the general formula is. I think really motivating and understanding it is probably beyond this lecture series, but I want to write it for you just so that you see it.
Dan, when you say the general formula, you mean the formula that fixes those two problems?
Yeah, that fixes those two problems. This is called the quantum extremal surface formula. It came out of a 10-year effort to fix up the previous formula. So it has the advantage of being more general and correct and disadvantage of being a bit more complicated. So it's actually almost all the same. So I won't write out all the text again. I'll just write out the formula. So we have again some boundary region R, but some state rho and some boundary region R, but now we don't demand time reversal symmetry. We do still demand that there is some semi-classical picture of the bulk, but it can allow things like superpositions as long as it's not too many superpositions of too many geometries at once. And so then I'll write the formula and then I'll just explain it a little bit. So there's a minimum over gamma as before, but now there's also an extremum over gamma sitting inside of that. And then we have the area of gamma plus some dot, dot, dot that we won't worry about divided by vor g, the same as before. But now we also add to this a bulk entropy of rho h. Where H is precisely this bulk region that lay in between gamma R and R, okay? So now the entropy in the bulk also contributes to the right-hand side of the formula. This gamma now does not have to lie in sigma. And in fact, sigma doesn't even have to exist because sigma existed because of time reversal invariance. So now we just take the extremum and then the minimum over all gammas, which are anchored to R and homologous to R. This is called a homologous to R, okay? Without restricting to them lying in any particular bulk slice, which in the end is what you want, because this should be covariant quantum gravity. There shouldn't be any preferred time slice that this prescription has to make reference to. So you know, it's a bit more complicated formula because you have to do this extremum and then the minimum, but the idea is not that different. So let me just make maybe a few comments about including this bulk thing and then we'll be done. So good features of this, right? So one is that this A over 4G plus S bulk was actually considered previously. This is what Bekenstein called the generalized entropy. And it's been shown in many cases to obey a second law and also to be universal and finite. So in particular, actually, these two terms separately at higher, once you include quantum mechanics, they're both infinite because G Newton gets renormalized and there's a divergence in the entanglement entropy of bulk fields. So that we discussed that last time, right? There's an infinite amount of entanglement in quantum field theory. But actually, this particular combination seems to be finite. It's been studied in great detail, and so it's a good thing to appear. Since this should maybe, you know, be finite, at least from bulk UV divergences, then this is a good combination to appear. The S bulk term clearly needs to be there. Needs to be there to account for entropic objects. Like if I put I put some huge magnet here with a million microstates in some very entropic state, then that would clearly, at least in the limit where I pull to the boundary, that would contribute to the entropy of this region. And since that's what I'm computing, it had better know about it. And then you can check that in simple situations, after you renormalize, then this S bulk becomes order one. And so then this reduces to the RT formula that we had before. Okay. So this somehow it can be understood as a generalization of the previous formula to situations where you don't have time reversal symmetry and you include quantum mechanics. Okay, so that's all I think all I'll say about this formula. I mean, it would be, you know, more lectures to try to further motivate why this is the right generalization and so on, but I'll just, hopefully it's at least a not too crazy looking generalization. And so I apologize for, again, once going over time by a little bit. I'm happy to stay a bit and answer questions if there are any. Or I can also answer them on Slack, I guess.
Can you say what was the, oh, sorry, someone else.
Please.
I think you're muted, Davide.
Yes, are there any questions? First and last question.
Yeah, I was just gonna ask, can you say again, what was the issue with the Ryu Takayanagi formula that the new formula is trying to fix?
Well, there were two issues. One was that it had this unreasonable assumption about time reversal symmetry, which why should we make that assumption? And the other was that it doesn't include quantum effects like this. If you have an entropic object in the bulk, then it seems that should contribute to the von Neumann entropy of the boundary, but it doesn't show up in this formula. It doesn't show up in the RT formula. So we somehow have to add this to include it. Yeah, there are other more kind of naive issues. Like, for example, if you look at, you know, just one thing that can bother you about this formula. So this S of rho is a nonlinear function of the state rho, but this is the expectation value of an observable. So that's a linear function of the state rho. And how can a nonlinear function of rho be equal to a linear function of rho, right? It sounds impossible. And so that bothered many people, including myself, when this formula was first proposed. But we've since understood that somehow the way to fix that is really to do this. And then now this is also a nonlinear function as well.